important topic, the challenging topic, the critical care training in India. Where do we stand and what is the future? So now we have with us Dr. Pradeep Kumar Bhattacharya, who is the Vice Chancellor of Indian College of Critical Care Medicine. He is a very well-known figure and a good orator. So let's listen from sir. So welcome, sir. So over to Dr. Pradeep Kumar, sir.
Hello, everybody. What I'm going to talk in next 15-20 minutes is about the critical care training in India. What does the past teach us, and what the present scenario, and what does the future hold? Now, as far as critical care training in India, we all know because the courses were started, although the efforts were started since the beginning of 1990s, but formally it could be started in the year 1999. And it was an independent effort taken by Indian Society of Critical Care Medicine on its own platform without any recognition from Medical Council of India or any other universities. And then it was the launched in a platform where two courses, one in the form of 1 year diploma course and another was 2 year fellowship course, it was started. Following which, two more courses were added later on, was a continuous training in critical care medicine that was for MBBS students, and then another was Indian diploma in critical care nursing for nursing students. Now, currently, we see that these are the four main basic courses which are being run by Indian Society of Critical Care Medicine all over the India. And currently, we have more than 200 recognized institutes, around 600 recognized teachers, and nearly 400 registered students at different institutes for who are doing these courses. So, what we need to understand, are we at par with the way the world is going as far as teaching, curriculum development, teaching and training methods are concerned, and assessment methods are concerned? Now, look at first of all, this curriculum development. We have four courses. One is Indian Diploma in Critical Care Medicine, another is Continuous Training in Critical Care Medicine, another third is Indian Diploma in Critical Care Nursing. These courses were developed based on some of the good courses which are launched at international levels, and from there we took our own ideas depending upon the Indian circumstances, and accordingly we developed those courses. But currently the scenario has changed worldwide, and curriculum development has completely gone in the format of competence-based medical education. Now, if we say that are we at par with them, I think no. We have to relook at our curriculum development, and then formally we have to develop our curriculum for different teaching courses which we are running. Second is teaching and learning methods. It is totally dependent upon the institutes who is running the course. We have not given from our side any kind of formal instructions how that student should be taught. Although we say that definitely the case presentations, journal clubs, and seminars, all those should be held at individual levels. But we have not given a formal training framework. Basically, what we need to give a proper framework how the thing should run, how the process of teaching and learning should be developed and given to individual students at individual institutes. Now, the third thing is assessment method. We have developed a good assessment method based on the methods which were developed in the Western world, and all those which were considered to be best assessment methods. Depending on that, we developed that. But again, those have become older ones, and now again we need to develop our assessment methods based on competence-based medical education system, because this is what is developing very fast all over the world, and India also has adopted. Now we know that National Medical Council of India is adopting that, and it is being implemented, or it's a continuous process, although It has been adopted by many of the medical institutes of our country. Growth, we are having a very consistent growth. Now, as I said, we have more than 200 institutes, and the training institutes are growing, the students are increasing, the number of faculties are increasing. And as far as IDCC exam pattern, although it is acceptable, but it is at par with the current recommendation of the World Health Organization or ACGME, you can say, but and also not at par with the recommendation which has been given by National Medical Council of India. So we do MCQs, we do short clinical cases, workstations, everything. But now the things are changing. And in IFCCM also, this is the structure, how we take our exams. But we need to relook into it and we need to change ourselves. And also the CTCCM exam, if we look the way we are doing it, we need a change. So based on the WHO recommendation, which came out in 2010, to take an initiative, they said that and they recommended that the health professional education should be competency based, and so that it can produce competent professionals and they could carry out their duties and fulfill the healthcare needs of people they serve. And the emphasis is basically shifting from teacher-centered, knowledge-dominant teaching of individual disciplines to integrated systems or learner-based system or system based on organ-based, that is specified to one particular organs, to problem-based learning. And that is the most important thing which we need to know in the current scenarios, looking at the problems which happen at different level while providing the facilities at different communities. So medical environment is changing rapidly and medical disputes are increasing. And this is what is a problem. People are losing faith on us and most patients have a sense of hostility towards inexperienced physicians. So the trial and error approach cannot be used to teach trainees how to manage critical illness because of safety reasons. And simulation, although is now we are moving towards that, it can provide a very good learning opportunities and facilitate repeat demonstration of similar scenarios in absence of stress environment. So we are moving towards competency-based medical education. And what is competency-based medical education? It is an outcome-based approach to the design, implementation, assessment, and evaluation of medical education program using an organized framework of competencies. So we, first of all, we define some important competencies which are required for a particular level. And depending on that competencies, we try to develop specific learning objectives. Like we say central venous catheterization is one of the competency one student we want to develop. So what are the things? First, you should know the theory of central venous catheterization. That is one of the specific learning objectives. Second is how to prepare the tray of putting central venous catheter, sterile tray, how to prepare. That is another specific learning objective. Then the third thing is that how to position the patient. That is also a specific learning objective. So we have to develop different specific learning objectives for different competencies. And accordingly, we have to develop our curriculum. So the design of competence-based system and education can be approached using following steps. First, identify the desired outcomes, what exactly we want. Define the level of performance of each competency. Develop a framework for assessing competencies and evaluate the program on a continuous basis to be sure that desired outcomes are being achieved. So it is a continuous process. It is not stopping anywhere, and the learning has to go on for lifelong in the form of a continuous. It's a continuous learning process, as I said. In 1999, the ACGME, and that is American Council of Graduate Medical Education and Board of Medical Specialties, they endorsed 6 domains of core competency. And these are the important things when we'll be talking about critical care also, because these are the 6 domains which we apply for various competencies. where it is applicable and whether it needs to be left developed or not. We'll look into it later on. So six domains are: first is patient care related, second is medical knowledge, third is professionalism, then interpersonal skill and communications, then practice-based learning and improvement, and system-based practice. So these are the six core competencies which one medical graduate or medical student or a resident needs to develop. So we all know that how we develop our experience and performance based on Miller's framework of clinical assessment. First of all, we develop knowledge, and then we develop competence, and then we perform ourselves, and then we act when we go to our practical field. When we perform, the performance that finally matters is the action which we provide to our society. And that is how we grow from novice to expertise. Initially, we are an instructor, and then finally we become a mentor. So this is a defined staging of learning. And what about CBME in India? In India, the need of CBME was recognized by Medical Council of India in 2012. And then they said that our Indian medical graduates should possess requisite knowledge, skill, attitude, values, responsiveness, so that he or she may function appropriately and efficiently as a physician of first contact of the community while being globally relevant too. So in 2012, India also started generating and developing these CBME goals, and they had they said that an Indian medical graduate, whomsoever comes up, should be a good clinician, he should be a good leader, communicator, he should be a lifelong learner and a good professional. So all these points is properly described in their pro forma. We can go into the detail in the website. Then why we always talk of competence-based education? What is the advantage? The primary advantage is that the focus is on success of each participant by ensuring that they achieve competencies required in the performance of their job. And being focused on learning for mastery and specific skills, they become more confident, and training time is used more effectively and efficiently as a trainer is a facilitator, or learning as opposed to provider of information. So it is basically a learners-based rather than teachers-based oriented. And this is how we differentiate learners paradigm, teacher-centered, student-centered. The CBME is student-centered. Here we more believe on formative assessment, problem-based teaching, competence-based, healthcare system needs-based, and we try to develop good professional and effective change of agent, and that is how it goes on. If we see the traditional method of medical education versus CBME, it is, as I said, it is outcome-based, it is learners-based, and assessment tools, when they are all authenticated, depends on the professional task with which they mature. And the assessment is basically on formative method. And the evaluation method, the assessment, which is done based on the Miller's pyramid, is initially it is the knowledge which they develop, then application of knowledge, following which demonstration of their clinical skills, and then daily patient care, how it is to be done at the final stage. So it is more as I said, emphasizes on formative assessment. So time to time evaluation during the course is very important, and it is outcome driven. That is the most important thing. So more focus on curriculum. It is content, obviously. Traditional education was content based. And when completion time is one of the important thing when we talk about, it is fixed as far as traditional teaching, which we are doing, but it is variable in competence based education. So finally, if we make a chart, it would come like this. When we depend on curriculum, and when we exactly depends on the healthcare needs of the system or outcome-based system. Now, there are three terminologies. One is competency, second is competent, and third is competence. So we need to understand, because all these things are important as far as CBME is concerned. Competency is an observable ability of a healthcare professional that integrates multiple components such as knowledge, skill, values, and attitude. What is competent? That means on that particular subject, you possess the required abilities in all domains in to a certain extent at defined stage of medical education or practice. And competence means you are completely knowledgeable, your skill is fully developed, and you need to require to apply to these to the environment where you are working for your need. Now, and that is, this is that the differences are shown in short, competency, competent, and competence. Now, as far as assessment is concerned, description of assessment tools of CBME curriculum, although we are doing some of them, but we have not applied it fully as far as our assessment in ACCM exams are concerned, like mini-sex, that is mini clinical examinations. Then we are following this Vigneault method for our short and long cases, but we are not using these DOPS, that is direct observational procedural skills or clinical examination skills. Although we are doing, we have to start OSCEs. OSCEs are obviously, we are incorporating in our system, but proper implementation may take some more time. Then direct performance measures based on long-term observation, collect then the other thing which are required is that feedback of the records or feedback of your learning, which is most important. That system also we need to develop. So if we apply this to the Miller's pyramid with the development from knowledge to from becoming an expert from novice, you see, as far as the top line is concerned, performance integrated and to practice, what we need to observe is workplace-based assessment, that is mini-sex, and global ratings and direct observation, that is DOPS, direct observations of procedural skills. And that level we need to achieve. So CBME is a great advance, but again, there are limitations of CBME, because operationalizing competencies for teaching and assessment is problematic in CBME. And hence, the entrustable professional activities were developed. They can revitalize that CBME by connecting competencies to practice. And that is what is EPA. And they are basically not an alternative to competencies, but a means to translate competencies into clinical practice. So how it is to be done? It is an important, it is very important to use EPS to verify whether a resident's ability to care for critically ill patients is unsupervised in a simulation scenario. And simulation scenario should be integrated to connect competencies to enhance critical care education. So it is a link from the starting, that is developing knowledge and finally applying it to the clinical practice. Educators are concerned. Initially they are all supervised by competent authorities, and then EPAs are executed, and the process and results can be observed separately or simultaneously depending on the competency level of the trainees. And then we need to determine whether the trainee possesses a trusted core ability which is appropriate for the society or not. So development of trusted core ability is the most important. So the six core competencies which was developed by ACGME, we will apply for different skills which we expect from our critical care students. So let us see some of the examples, like mechanical ventilator. We need to know medical knowledge. We need the patient care, the student must know, then professionalism. These three things are important for medical ventilator setting. Like we are talking about executing a patient handover. So for these, we need medical knowledge, we need patient care, we need interpersonal skill and communication. We should have a good professional skill. And then system-based practice also we need to develop. So all those things we need to test one after another. And then finally, you can say that, yes, he has developed the core competency, which is actually required as far as EPA, that is entrustable professional activity, is concerned. Like family conference or telling a bad news to the family, What we need to develop is ISC, that is interpersonal skill and communication. We need to have a good professional skill, then only we can convey. And finally, the SBP, that is system-based practice, how we practice it. And so these three things need to be monitored and assessed. So that is how we develop ourselves for the next generation. So the next core, what is our next goal? The core competencies are now the basic language for defining physician competence and are also the principle used in training of physicians. So then our next goal of CBME is to link education in the competencies to improve quality of patient care. So finally, once we link all these core competencies that we are mastered to the quality, then we'll say that yes, now our chain is closed and we have developed the topmost skill which actually is required for our society. So this ambition step will require a standardized method to securely collect patient data and stratify for various clinical variables, including disease specificity, overall patient health, and multitude of healthcare professionals who care for each patient. So that is how we are growing in the next generation. It will take time, but I think with a consistent effort, and we are trying hard to develop our ISSM curriculum, not only curriculum, teaching learning methods, as well as assessment methods in near future, and we'll be doing a lot many things. So thank you for now, today, listening to me for this topic. Thank you very much.